Good morning. All right, we're about 10 o'clock. We'll fit in a word here somehow, won't we? It's a lot of worship and communion, which is amazing though, isn't it? I'd rather spend more time in worship, but I mean, there's guys who I do want to talk, and I love talking, speaking, right? But it's all right. Have a good morning as you're grabbing your seats. Lots happening here. Just a reminder about Easter week. I know it's Easter week or Resurrection week, whatever you want to call it. We'll have communion here on Wednesday night with kind of an intimate worship and communion. Then remember, Friday night, we'll have Randy Clark. And it's good. We love doing these things on purpose, intentionally. And people usually have time off. So come join us, okay? If you've never been here on a sunrise service, it is really worth coming out, okay? We do it in front of the building, outside. It's really cool, followed by breakfast. And it keeps getting bigger and bigger. Every year, there's more added. So we're excited to have you come be a part. If you haven't done that, it's just cool because the sunrise is right over there, right on it. It's great. And this year, it's actually the latest. It's been in a long time. So hopefully it'll be over 35 degrees and the musicians' fingers won't freeze on their guitars, you know? And we'll sing happily without like, get us out of here, it's freezing. All right, it's cool. It's just something different. You know what I mean? Having church outside, it's just a great thing to do. So, hey, lots of good things going on around here, right? Yes, Bryan, there is, man. Good, it just got lost in the worship. I just can't many people get, just enjoy it. Really good to enjoy it instead of like, are they done yet? It's like, no, keep going. That's really good. So, hey, well, listen, just to, encouraging you to send us, you have a testimony about a miracle. Please send it in at miracles@lcmi.org. We'd love to hear them. Can I read one for you real quickly? Just got it this week, which is really, really great. And I think it happened a few weeks ago, but we finally got it into our box here, and it's really great. A lady said she's been trying to send a testimony of her son's healing deliverance. This was a week ago, a couple weeks ago, our son became deathly ill with the flu. And this lady attends here. It became so bad that it shot his blood pressure and blood sugar sky high. He was admitted into the hospital. Doctors tried hard to stabilize him. They couldn't. Finally had to take him and put him in the ICU. His lungs were starting to give out, so they intubated him, put a breathing tube in, induced coma. I mean, this is pretty intense, isn't it? And he put gloves on him because he's trying to rip out the tubes and all that kind of stuff. And really crazy, deep coma. A group from Life Center came and prayed for him about the fourth day. This is really good. It gets really good because she's like, I don't even know who their names were. They just came from the church. Isn't that awesome? And by the sixth day, he started awakening, recognizing people. They took all the breathing tubes out, so many models, tubes, all these machines hooked up. By day seven, he was sitting up. Doctors came and examined him, and he said, I've never seen, this is a doctor's statement, I've never seen such a rapid turnaround. And she said to him, that's the power of prayer. Isn't that good? Come on, so a few more days he's sent home. It's just, you gotta hear that stuff, right? Come on, I know, just because, man, you get a son or daughter, come on, how many parents we got in the room? Come on, you have a child get sick, it's like, gloves are off, baby, we're at war now. Do you know what I mean? It's like, all right. But I just want to start out today and tell you, I really believe, and I know how many people enjoyed Charles's message last week. Come on, all access, and I refer to that. But we're in a season, an unusual season at Life Center. I know it always seems like that, but really, after being here many years, we are in an unusual season, and I would call it a season of opportunity. And I think Charles or John or someone here recently, maybe Chris was speaking, we do have an opportunity, and I believe our opportunity, one of the things we want to see God breakthrough, as we've heard the word about across the nation of, you know, God's people having breakthrough this year, but really we have an opportunity in prayer. And as clear as day, I was sitting here last week, and I just, during worship, got wrecked in worship. I felt like God's like, ask me and ask me specifically. And it's one of those questions or thoughts you get in your heart, it rises up like, it's like just strike the rock over and over. Do you remember the part in the Bible? Like, we just can go for it in the season. And I feel like the Lord said, ask me and ask specifically, okay? And I just really know we're in a place where this is an awesome thing to happen. And I know when you talk about prayer, when you're in a community as large as Life Center, we have all kinds of people on a gamut that think of when you talk about prayer, they're all over the map. And I had someone here recently come to Marston and say, oh, I've been praying for one of your children. And they've been here a good 20 plus years, mature in the Lord. And man, they just tracked right on. Like, we've been praying for, you know, one of your children and this and this and this. And it's awesome to know that they're praying. And then right after that, I had an encounter with a young man who recently gave his heart to the Lord. And he said, man, how do I pray? Like, teach me how to pray. And he's in a part of our community here. He's like, dude, this is new to me. And how many people have been there? I know when I got saved, I had no idea, you know? And then I ran into a guy that I've been praying for. He's really busy, has a very big, responsible job. And he's like, man, I'm just so busy, I don't have time to pray. And I thought, there's so many, you know, people on the gamut of prayer and understanding prayer is just conversation with God. So can I give you a few hints about prayer? Is that okay? I know this. See, some people tend to hear like, all we talk about is worship and prayer. That might be a good thing, okay? All right? His house is to be a house of prayer, right? House of worship, right? Hopefully we're doing that or else we're missing a major part of the kingdom, okay? So stay with me because I want to encourage you. When I first got saved, I had no idea about prayer. And I always joke about it. People are like, you need to have a little quiet time with God. When I literally thought, take a nap with Jesus. I had no idea. They told me quiet time, walked away. I'm like, what is a quiet time? Like a devotional would have been a better word, all right? But it's basically a conversation with the Lord. It's as much listening as it is speaking to him. Do you understand? It's really important, okay? So a few couple keys. Number one, we approach him or come to him with humility. Humility prayer requires humility. Why? We're coming to him saying, God, you're bigger. You're the one who created me. You're the one who made me. You got a big plan for my life that I can't see. And you know, whatever you want to do, but you get into a place where you humble. It requires humility to humble ourselves and come before the Lord and say, God, you're God and I'm not. And I'm asking, I'm praying, I'm interceding, I'm whatever, you know, the gamut of prayer is, okay? And we're basically saying you are God, okay? 2 Chronicles chapter 7 is a really great scripture to memorize. It's one of the first scriptures of a zillion that I tried to put in my soul and get it. But 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. Many of you guys are familiar with this. It says, if my people who are called by my name, how many people are called by his name? He says this big word, humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. Then he says this great answer. He says, then I will hear from heaven. I'll forgive their sin and I will heal their land. Isn't that a good promise? Like, he's, look, man, if you come before me, I'm going to hear your prayer. It's like a win-win. If you're a business person, you're like, I got it, bud. This isn't hard, all right? But verse 15 goes on and it says this great thing, and I'll come back to it later, but he's like, I'm hearing your prayers. My ears are attentive to your prayer at this time, and my eyes are open to what's going on in this house. And I believe that's a word for Life Center, and I'll come back to that. But I really believe we have so much power in prayer. Do you know what? It's one of those powerful weapons we own as Christians. And I know you're like, yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, it's the most powerful thing you can do. You're sitting here today, I believe with all my heart, because someone prayed for you. Do you know that? Come on. And there's other people sitting here because you've prayed for them. It's so good. I'm sitting here because my brother and sister-in-law prayed for me when I was totally didn't care and was against the kingdom of God. They're like, we're going to keep praying and God will wear you down. If I can say it in a good way. You know what I mean? Keep opening my mind to God. All right. But you can change. I believe we have so much power. You can change the mind of God. Do you believe that? It's in scripture. People say God doesn't change. Of course, his character doesn't change. Who he is doesn't change. But there's parts in the Bible where Moses prayed and God relented. He was going to wipe out the nation. I'm just going to kill them all. And Moses is like, no. Really, just for a few, save us. Isn't that awesome? And it says he relented, changed his mind, as other versions say it. This is huge, guys. This is a huge, powerful thing of prayer. Do you understand it? Okay, so we come. It requires us to humble ourselves. Secondly, we approach God with thanksgiving. Everybody say thanksgiving. Come on, thanksgiving is one of the most powerful things we can do. It says in Psalm 110, it says, we enter his gates with what? Thanksgiving, and we enter his courts with praise. Come on. I sat with a young guy a few years ago when I was working in the youth ministry, and he said, where do I begin with thanks? And I'm like, where do I begin with thanks? And how many people are parents have ever done that little routine with their children? Like, we're going to go around the table and say what you're thankful for. Anybody ever done that? And I remember being so anxious when our kids are little. I'm like, if you don't have like 100 things in 5 seconds, I was like, and trying to be really quiet, I'm going to eat our dinner. Like, there's so much to be thankful for, okay? And I'm like, so I remember sitting with this guy. I'm like, man, you could just start with the baseline. I was like, thank you, God, for making yourself real to me. Thank you for saving me. Do you know that? Thank you, I'm alive and not dead. That was definitely my case, right? Thank you, I'm not in jail. Thank you for coming into my life, filling me with your Holy Spirit. Thank you for loving me, forgiving me. Come on, filling me. Isn't it good? Are you guys there? There's so much to be thankful for. His Holy Spirit, his goodness, his kindness. Just go on and on and on. Thank you for your word that has been preserved, that is truthful. It's not like the New York Times. It's all truth, the Bible. Isn't that good? There's so much to be thankful for. I remember practicing this when I first got saved. I was so happy I was alive. Okay, like, I'm not dead. But I remember practicing, like, God, thank you. Do you understand? I was a poor college student, like, no money, just got to make sure you can keep the electric on, and it was heat in the winter, and you know what I mean? And I remember, God, thank you, there's hot water in the shower. Thank you for this soap. Thank you for this shampoo. Thank you, I have clothes to put on my body. Thank you for a bed to sleep in with a pillow. Thank you for windows in my windows. You know what I mean? Are you guys there? There's so much to be thankful for. You can just go off on it. Thank you for everything. Thank you for coffee, my food, my breakfast, refrigerator that keeps my food cold in an oven that heats it and makes it, cooks it, all right? Are you with me? Come on, man, you gotta get out of this place. Thanksgiving and humility is like this great attitude to approach the Lord. I believe it keeps believers in a place of joy. Do you know that? Come on, I don't wanna be a bitter Christian, like, yeah, I was once joyful, but you know, you gotta get these, shut up, and it doesn't mean age. I've met 25-year-old bitter Christians that have got so, anyhow, messed up. It's like, man, stay happy. But you keep yourself in a place of humility and a place of thankfulness, you're gonna stay in a place of joy. Yeah, I got it, bro. I totally believe that, all right? Come on, there's so much to be thankful for. Are you there? Come on, the list is endless. That's before you leave your house. You leave your house, thank you for nature. Thank you for the trees. Thank you for the grass. Thank you for sunshine in Harrisburg in April 2nd. Come on, isn't it good? Okay, so we come with him, we're gonna be humble. We're gonna come with thanksgiving. Third, we come to as his sons and daughters and he is our Father. This is so simple. So many people get mixed up. Who am I praying to? He's our heavenly Father. Remember Jesus, the whole squad came to him. How do you teach us to pray? What does he say? Our Father who is in heaven. Remember that? He's our Father. Isn't that good? It's so awesome. He's a perfect Father. If you had a messed up father, and I think almost every father in America had some kind of dysfunction, come on, all right? Get over it. I was the fifth out of six kids. I was like, hey, mom, hey, dad, all right, yeah, what's you, come here. And some of my brothers, they had other names that were like bad names. Like SOB and damn, come here. I'm like, that's not their name. Sorry, all right? Are you with me? Come on. So get over it. He's our heavenly Father and he's perfect in every way a father could be. It's so wonderful, right? Okay, fourth, we're gonna pray according to his will. When I say this to people and I talk about prayer, this is where people can get so mixed up. It's the will of God. You know what? The Bible is the will of God. Come on, how many people have an electronic Bible? Mine's all loaded in this thing. All right, it's good. But it's the will of God is what it says. The Old Testament will of God, the New Testament and will of God. All right, you there? Come on. And so much we know by his word what his will is. What do you mean, Bryan? I know health and healing is his will. Jesus went about healing all kinds of people. That's what he did, right? It's true. It's his name, Jehovah Rapha, the Lord who heals, right? Come on. It's what he is. That's not a question in my mind. I know that's his will. Do you understand that? You can go through a whole list of stuff just according to the Bible. We know it's his will. Do you understand that? Come on. I know it's his will for all men to be saved. It says it in 2 Timothy, or 1 Timothy 2, chapter 2, verses 3 and 4. It says his will is for all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. Isn't that good? Oh, that guy will just never get saved. You know, that's not true. God wants that's his will for him to be saved. So when you start praying for a coworker, a friend, a neighbor, somebody that you know, a relative, a sibling, okay, a son and daughter, it's God's will that they be saved. Do you understand that? So we getting this? Is this clear? It's so clear in so many stuff. I know God loves provision. He's our provider, all right? It's who he is, right? He wants his children to be provided for. He says in 3 John 2, I pray that you prosper and be in health as your soul prospers. And in Psalm 37, I said, I've not seen the righteous begging bread or his descendants begging bread. It's who he is. It's another one of his names. Yahweh Yireh, Jehovah Jireh, right? The Lord will provide. Isn't that good? So much we know about it, walking in his will. We know it's his will. We know it's his will to walk in love, to walk in forgiveness, to care about people generally, to have peace in our hearts, order in our homes, on and on and on and on, okay? And then there are certain things the Lord has spoken to our hearts and we know it's his will. It's not in the word of God, but you know that you know that you know he spoke to your heart. How many people have that happened? I know this is the will of God. I know this is the direction he's leading me. I have a decision to make. I know he spoke to my heart. I know this is what I'm supposed to do. How many people know that? Come on, I know we moved in this building and it wasn't this section, it was the other facility. We knew that we knew that we knew. We had a half a dozen, it's like, dude, we're supposed to be in that building. Now, this is when God speaks to you. It's usually contrary to your circumstances. It can look completely opposite. We put an offer on this building and Tyco just ignored it, didn't even acknowledge us. Suppose it was bought by a whole other company. 9 months later, he'd call from the realtor. Hey, bub, you never believe this. We're like, yeah, we will. We've been praying. We know that we know. Isn't that crazy? And even the realtors were like, well, you need this building for. We're like, we just know it'll work for us. We know that we're supposed to be here. Isn't that great? Even the people working for us were against us. Right? Sorry. Do you understand that? Come on, I remember meeting Ricardo like years ago. Ricardo, we met him like 89 or 90. And we just thought Ricardo's gonna be here. But the part where God speaks to you that we can get messed up is in timing. Even when we felt the Lord gave us a word in 92, like I see a building high on a hill when Kim Clement gave us to us, it wasn't until the year 2000. We met Ricardo, man. All of us were like, Ricardo's going to be here. Well, he came back, what, 12, 15 years later. Then he came and joined us. Wasn't that awesome? Do you get it? So this is so good. We know these things. I remember coming back to Harrisburg. I finished Penn State. I was a youth pastor for about 2.5 years, almost 3 years in state college. And I remember coming back for Christmas. And the Lord said, move back to Harrisburg. And I knew I'd come back to this place. I had no idea about the church at all. I thought I'd go get a real job. Okay, as a youth pastor, I'm not going to get a real job because that's just like too hard. Sorry. Okay. I remember meeting my wife, Marcy. I knew I'm going to marry this girl. And she was engaged to somebody else. Now that's like, gloves are off. I know that's unfair, but sorry, man. I just knew that I knew. I just knew it in my heart. And I didn't go to her and say, the Lord told me. That'd be like stupid, okay? Which people do today. Don't pull the God card. Sorry, folks. If you're under 20, don't use that. I would be like, that doesn't work, okay? Sorry, I'll get in trouble if I do that. Okay, so don't do that, all right? But there's this amazing confidence we have when we know that it's when we know the will of the Lord. Don't you know what I mean? First John chapter 5, verse 14, it says, this is the confidence that we have before him. If we ask anything according to his will, what happens? He hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whenever we ask, we know that we have the requests we've asked from him. Isn't that good? That's not being cocky. It's just being confident. I know that I know that I know it's going to be okay. Like, we knew the building. We didn't. We just knew it. And John, we just, Marcy, we knew the building. We're like, we're going to be here. We know it. Now, little did we know when we got to get to the building, they said, great, you guys can have the building, but we don't have enough collateral. So you need like 8 or 10 of you to put your homes on the list too to get the building. And I remember sitting in the meeting with all the guys, and we're like, let's do it. And one of the guys and the elder said, maybe we should ask our wives. We're like, good point. We're still gonna do it. Do you know what I mean? That wasn't, but we heard the word was, it'll be given unto you. That's, you know, I don't know how that works out, but we're here. Okay, yay. Sorry. That's kind of like given to us, got to put our homes on the line. I don't know about that, but we'll figure it out. All right. So this is awesome. Are you guys with me? Now there are times where you really don't know. You're like, God, I don't know your will. What's the deal here? What am I supposed to do? Okay, a really good point to go back to and to pray is Matthew chapter 6, verse 10. He says, your kingdom come, your will be done. If I don't know the will of the Lord on a certain subject, I'm like, God, I don't know. So your will be done. All right? Is that good? Everybody tracking with me? Isn't that awesome? Another key when you don't know the will of God is to pray in tongues like a maniac. Well, pray in tongues. Isn't that one of those like weird incantations? Man, if you don't have a baptism of the Holy Spirit and have a prayer language, you're missing part of it because it's amazing, all right? But you can pray all the time. Pray, 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 pray in tongues like a maniac, okay? Besides praying the Ephesians, pray, oh Lord, open the eyes, give me a spirit of wisdom and understanding. But Romans 8, chapter 8, verse 26, man, I have so much here to unload and I'm trying to press through. It says in verse 26, in the same way the Spirit also helps our weaknesses, we don't know how to pray as we should, the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. Are you getting there? Look, this is something you practice and practice and practice, praying in tongues. I do it. I've done it for years and years and years. When I first got involved in a church, I was involved in a church outside of State College. It was about 40 minutes from Penn State. I lived in State College, and my morning commute was almost 40 minutes. I practiced just praying in tongues the entire 40 minutes going there. Now, there was a six-month stint where there we did every morning 6 o'clock prayer 5 days a week. And then on this one other day, I had to be there because that was Sunday. It's crazy. So I got it in my spirit, like praying in tongues was amazing. Like you get to a different place. I don't know how to define it. I don't know how to explain it to you. You just got to turn off your brain and pray. Okay? Do you understand that? And in the middle of your praying, you'll sometimes pray in the spirit and sometimes you'll pray with the understanding and you'll get downloads, you'll get pictures, you'll get things like, I just know that's it. Do you understand? Come on, this is one of the most powerful things that is not talked about a lot in the body of Christ. It's one of the most powerful tools we have. Okay? It's so good, man. I challenge you to do it. Okay, I still half my morning commute from like 8 miles away. I'll pray in tongues. It's just something I've done and made it a practice and made it a practice. I've avoided accidents like, shalabai, oh, helakulia, change lanes. I'm serious. I am not kidding. I've avoided stuff like go another direction to work and I'm not sitting in an hour of traffic. I know that sounds crazy. Does it all work out perfectly? No, but I'm praying, all right? Come on. Can I just add on to that? The Bible says to pray always. I know I've talked to people about this, and I remember talking to teenagers going like, pray always, man, what are you talking about? Like, you've lost your mind, you know? I'm like, no, you can pray all the time. As soon as your eyes open, make this practice of like, this is the day the Lord has made. I can rejoice and be glad in it. I thank you, God, that I'm alive and I'm breathing. Thank you, I have blood in my veins. And you can go on and on and on. And all through your day, you can pray while you're getting showered. Thank you, God, for clean hands, pure heart. I want to live for you today. While you're cleaning your house, you're cutting your grass, you're washing your car, whatever you're doing, making coffee, folding the laundry, okay? changing diapers at 4 a.m. I know, that's like crazy. Pray for your kids then. Do you hear me? You can do this all the time. I know God didn't say this stuff to make us out of our mind. I mean, when you're working out. I've been working out so much in the last couple of years because I'm doing these triathlons. So I bike, like yesterday I biked for an hour and 10 minutes. I'm like, I make it a prayer time. I just pray for all the neighborhoods I'm driving through. Why not? Do you know what I mean? It's so good when I'm running, because she goes a lot slower than biking. Like, here I'm running, I can pray for neighbors by name. Is it crazy? Oh, don't you get tired? No, it actually helps me get through it, right? But you can pray for all the people in your life too, all the time. Pray for your people. I mean, pray for your family, start there. Come on, how many parents do we have in the room? Pray for your kids all the time. Right? And if you've got older parents, pray for them all the time. But you can pray for everybody, your coworkers, your bosses, your coaches, your roommates, your teammates. Do you know what I mean? All the friends, all your clients, all your employees, all your bosses. Are you there? Come on, how about you just pray for the people that service you every day? How about the mailman? You see him, pray for him, man. Pray for the coffee barista you see a couple times a week. Pray for him. It's awesome, isn't it? Do you understand that you can pray all the time? It becomes a lifestyle. You're just doing it. You're not a weirdo, okay? I don't like being weird, okay? And you're like, really? You look like it? Come on. You can pray for your mechanic, the person who does your hair, the school board, your neighbors, your representatives, the governor, the president. We need to pray. I remember praying for President Obama when he came in office. I'm like, man, I disagree with some of the policies. I got to pray for the guy. It's in scripture. I don't want to, right? Come on. Same way with the current president. Let's pray for people all the time. It's so good. Got it? Are you with me? Okay, Bryan. A couple more? Are we all right? We're almost there. Ask. This is another key thing. People are like, what do you mean in prayer? Ask him. Ask him. What do you mean? Ask in prayer. James says this crazy thing. He says, sometimes you don't have because you don't ask. Well, I wouldn't dare to ask for that. Why not? Ask a dangerous prayer. Ask something that's beyond your imagination. That's what God's looking for in this season specifically, and I'll come back to that, all right? But ask, it says in John chapter 14, chapter 15, chapter 60, multiple verses. He just says, ask. Ask in my name. Ask in his name. Do you understand that? In his name, in Jesus' name. You remember when Charles talked about that all access? That's the access we have. A number of years ago, I had an opportunity to go to the ESPY Awards. I don't know if people know the ESPY Awards, sports awards. Now they've become a really big deal. But this is like the early 2000s, three or four, something like that. Anyhow, I went with my brother, and his company was a big sponsor in the ESPYs. So we got there, and they gave us, boom, a colored badge that meant all access. It was awesome. I remember walking out. LeBron James is right there. You know, they had the athletes on one side, the VIPs, and he ran you through the tent, you know, and checked, make sure you're not carrying any whatever at that time, you know. And we walk out, and I remember going like, hey. I mean, he's literally like, I'm like, hey. And they were snapping pictures, of course, of me, not LeBron. You know, I was like, hey, I'm here. I'm really amazing, right? Like, I was snapping pictures of LeBron, okay? Sorry, but it was awesome. But the part I remember was all access, whatever we wanted. We got in the elevator with all the Pistons, Detroit Pistons. They were just one. I'm like, this is really amazing. My boys were like, I can't believe. You don't even know who they are. I'm like, yeah, I do. Are you there? But do you understand? I had all access that was totally open. The name of Jesus is the most powerful name. He says, ask anything in my name. Now, to add on to that, I've talked to people, so I ask. Ask and keep asking and keep asking. That's what it says in Matthew chapter 7 in the Amplified Version. It says, ask, keep asking. Seek and keep seeking, right? Knock and keep knocking. Keep asking, man, all right? God, I know you're the perfect father, but maybe you don't hear me, so I'm going to keep asking, all right? Sometimes I don't know why it doesn't respond, but it's not going to stop me from asking. Do you understand that? Come on, keep doing it, all right? It's the most powerful thing we can do. How many people are in need of something right now in your life? Come on, you need wisdom, you need strength, you need revelation, you need direction. We can pray for this stuff and God releases understanding to our lives, all right? Come on, how many people have a very key person in your life? And if you're with your husband and wife, you should be raising your hand. Yes, your spouse, or maybe you have a business partner, or maybe you have a coworker. They're very important to what you're doing in your life. You want to pray for them all the time. Do you understand that? What, a year and a half ago, Patty started the Women at Life? Was that about a year and a half ago? At the same time, jumped in with a prayer. She got attacked on all kinds of sickness, all kinds of issues, man. She needed prayer support at that point. She was key to what's going on here that affects our entire community of believers. Man, we were like, hey, that's enough. Like, time out. Do you understand that? Come on, prayers, praying for each other is so good. And we're a great opportunity to do this right now, all right? Come on, praying for someone. How many people, you might have a son or daughter went off to college. They need your prayers, man, especially in the secondary universities, even Christian colleges, they need your prayers, all right? Or maybe your son or daughter just finished and they went and got a big job. You need to pray for them and cover their lives in prayer, all right? Come on, maybe you're launching a business with somebody and you need to pray for each other all the time. Why? The first thing the enemy is gonna do is try to bring division between you. Come on, I've seen so many businesses and there's the potential's amazing. They get stuck and get divided. It's like, come on, stay together, see it through. You there? This is so good, man, I'm telling you. We're about to, I mean, embark on this project doing a balcony here. We need to cover it in prayer like crazy. Why? Because I want to see when the balcony's finished, I want to see us have more momentum, burning more for God than when we started the project. Do you understand that? Come on, anytime churches get in building projects, I've heard of all the horror stories. Before we moved here, about 4 months or so before we moved to this building, I just got on a tire ride, so we're going to have prayer 3 times a day. We started doing the morning 6 to 8, we did around noontime, and then we did an evening. We started praying and praying and praying just to cover the move. I didn't want to lose one person that was a part of attending Life Center. I said, I forbid it. And you know what? We didn't. We had more people when we showed up here. People came just to see what God is doing. Isn't that good? Come on, it's something that God wants to do. But anytime we change something, what is it? Statistics say 3/4 of the people, oh, don't want to change it now. I'm used to this. So we change the balcony. It's going to change the dynamics in this room. So what? I want us to be totally more in love with God when we finish it, right? It's just one little thing going on here, all right? Isn't it good? Come on. We can make lifestyle, a prayer, a lifestyle. Worship is a key in that. Do you know that? Worship is prayer. And I love we do like 30 to 40 minutes of it every time we gather in this house. It's awesome. You know what I mean? It's the best. I first got saved, I didn't have this kind of worship. I had, we bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. It wasn't even that cool. It was a little less, okay, sorry. You know what I mean? I took the bulletins home and sang them on my bed so I felt the presence of God come in my room and I thought, there you are, God. I just wanna sing till I feel you, till I know you're here with me. And now I get songs like they're singing this morning. No other name, it's amazing. Isn't this good? Come on, let's all stand. We'll just worship for a minute and don't leave. I got a couple more things I want to say here. Come on. Go ahead.
Death could not hold you. The veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring. The praise of your glory for you.
Stay with it just for a minute here. Listen to scripture, 2 Chronicles 7, verse 15. It's the word I know God's spoken to us in this time. It says, this is the word for this time. Now my eyes will be open and my ears attentive to the prayer offered in this place. I'm telling you, we had this word years ago. I don't know if it was 12, 13 years ago when we first got in this sanctuary. Know that I know God spoke this to my heart. So what does that mean? Let's pray wild prayers. Pray wild, specific prayers. Let's go for it, guys. We're in such a great season. Be a part of prayer life. If you can't be a part of prayer life, man, just get the time in your own life and pray. Pray for stuff that you've dreamed about. Say, God, could I see it in my lifetime? I'm telling you, God will do these things, all right?
Yeah.
All right? Pull it back. One of the greatest prayers any man or woman or child can pray is praying and saying, Jesus, forgive me for my sin. Come into my life and change my heart. And God will do it. Come on, there's no bad prayers. I got to tell you that. Some of you guys are saying, well, I got to go all these guidelines. I'm telling you, there's no bad prayer. God will hear the faintest whisper of your heart. He hears it. Do you understand that? I know it's the other extreme end, but he does. So if you don't know the Lord, if you're here this morning going, Bryan, this is completely new to me, I'm telling you, all you have to do is say, Jesus, forgive me of my sins. I'll come into my life. Make yourself real to me. I want to know you. And he'll do it right now, right here. Okay? Can we do that? Come on, ministry team, come on. Got a ministry team here this morning. We'll pray. It's good, isn't it? Come on, it's a good season we're in, guys. I'm telling you, I know. The Lord said, my eyes are attentive, my ears are attentive, opening to what you're doing at this time, in this hour, in this house. Does this make us any more special than any other church? No, I just know that's what God's doing here, okay? Does this sound good? Come on, if you're close enough to someone, connect to them somehow. Lay a hand gently on their shoulder or grab their hand if you're with family. Let's just pray for a second. And then we'll open the altar. If you need prayer for anything, we want to pray for you before you leave, all right? Come on, Father, we just thank you for what you're doing in this place. Thank you for what you're doing in our hearts. God, we pray that, God, would you just give us the grace to pray in this season, to pray wild, crazy prayers, God. Come on, beyond our imagination, beyond what we can even think or imagine, Father, we pray. Let those things bubble up in our hearts in this season, Father. God, we ask you, Lord, for grace, 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 to press in, Father, to pray specifically, to hold each other up in prayer, not to judge each other, but to speak well of one another and speak well of each other in prayer, God. Help us to do this, we pray. God, bless this time in Jesus' name. Come on. Amen. Bless that person beside you. Amen. Amen. Hey, the altar's open, man. We'd love to pray for you for any of these areas, all right?